melanoma of the upper limb where there is nodal involvement. Okay, in melanoma, you can also do sentinel node biopsy of the axillary node or the regional nodes. And then depending on the sentinel node involvement, just as in breast cancer, perform the axillary lymph node dissection. So due to removal of the axillary nodes, we have a lymphedema of the upper limb. So, and it is fairly common depending on how you study it. There are different definitions of lymphedema of the upper limb, and based on that definition and the time when you measure it, you know, you will get a lymphedema. And in general, lymphedema is very common soon after the operation, about 2 to 3 months later. And as you follow these patients about 4 to 5 years later, the incidence of the lymphedema will go down thanks to development of the collateral drainage and abnormal pathways opening up. So let's, and please remember, there is no cure. There is no cure for lymphedema, okay? Once lymphedema sets in, there is no cure. You can only reduce or ameliorate it, the symptoms or the trouble caused by lymphedema, but there is no cure. There is no cure for lymphedema, so we must make every effort to prevent it, okay? And lymphedema causes deterioration in the quality of life of a person. And I have seen ladies with grossly swollen limb, so much so that they could not walk. They had to be supported by their daughter or somebody in the house to go to the bathroom and do their change their clothes and wash. The limb was so heavy that they could not move. Right, so what is the basic pathophysiology? Once lymphedema sets in due to blockade of the lymph nodes, you have repeated episodes of inflammation or cellulitis. And it's actually the first inflammation occurs in the lymphatics. So it's a lymphangitis. So lymphangitis, and it may progress to inflammation. So cellulitis will be later. Initially, you'll have episodes of lymphangitis, which will cause swelling and mostly caused by staphylococcus or streptococcus infection. Okay, staphylococcus is the commonest organism, and sometimes streptococcus also. And they're almost always sensitive to penicillin. Dr. Olszewski is a great name in the field of lymphedema research. And he has conducted, he's about 85-year-old gentleman. He's a surgeon from Poland, Warsaw, School of Medicine. And he has dedicated his lifetime to carry out basic research and preventive research in the field of lymphedema. He visits, he's a friend of India. He visits every year to AIIMS and to various places in India. He established the Lymphedema Society of India. And he used to work with various plastic surgeons, mostly in Banaras Hindu University, with plastic surgeons, and where he set up a Lymphedema Center of India. And so he is a great proponent of the theory that they're mostly caused by staphylococcal infection and sometimes a streptococcal infection. And after I finish, then I will request Dr. Anita Dhar, who's a professor of vascular surgery in our department. He has done extensive work and research with Dr. Olszewski's team in Poland, and she will add whatever I have missed. Okay. And they did some study where they found that it's mostly low-grade staphylococcal infection, and which is almost always sensitive to penicillin. And that's why he proposes that if you inject benzathine penicillin, 1.2 mega units or 12 lakh units, as it is called in our country, 12 lakh units, deep intramuscular after sensitivity test for a year, then you can reduce these episodes of inflammation. Okay, so Dr. Anita carried out a study where she used benzathine penicillin along with the usual care for prevention of lymphedema in patients who were undergoing axillary lymph node dissection. Okay, so it was a two-arm parallel design randomized control trial, and she took a large sample and with a long-term follow-up, and as the inclusion criteria were patients who were diagnosed who were undergoing axillary node dissection. We have already discussed, you know, axillary node dissection, so I'll not go in detail. So all adult patients were randomized with no allergy to benzathine penicillin. So the benzathine penicillin patients were allocated to receive 1.2 mega units or 12 lakh units of benzathine penicillin deep intramuscular at 3-weekly interval for 1 year. But in this study, they studied at 6 months. And upper limb, along a standard of care, the control arm was where limb exercise was offered along with advice for skin hygiene and avoidance of trauma, such as use any sharp needles or embroidery, or use sharp knife while peeling the vegetables in the kitchen, or don't go for gardening on say thorny plants like cacti or rose, etc. So these were the general advice given to the control arm, and so the objective was to measure the incidence of lymphedema in the operated limb. Okay, and they also studied other complications like surgical site infection. I will say lymphangitis. Cellulitis is a later event. Dr. Anita, I think, will correct, but I will call it lymphangitis in the upper limb, because primary inflammation is of the lymphatics, and then later on cellulitis will set in. And they also measured the anesthesia and quality of life. So how was lymphedema defined? So let us just talk how the lymphedema is defined. So there are various definitions. Increase in the girth of the limb more than 200 ml, more than 200 ml in volume. This is the most precise definition. Increase in the volume of the limb more than 200 ml from the baseline. Baseline is from the pre-operative limb volume. If you have not recorded it pre-operatively and patient just comes to you and you think that she has lymphedema, then you can measure the diameter of the contralateral if you do not have the baseline value. Okay, so to increase in the volume of the limb more than 200 ml from the baseline of the same limb, or more than 200 ml increase in volume from the contralateral limb, contralateral being normal. Okay, so that is one definition. It's considered one of the most precise method of defining lymphedema. Other methods are measuring the cross-sectional diameter, and if you take it at several points and then take an average, more than 2 cm increase in the girth, more than 2 cm increase in the circumference of the upper limb compared to the pre-therapy or pre-operative. So 2 cm increase in diameter, or more than not diameter, circumference, or 200 ml increase in volume. Okay, so these are the two definitions. And how we measure it? We measure it by immersing the, you know, take a large bucket of water with a measuring flask attached to the nozzle, and let the patient immerse her hand into it, and then you measure the volume of the water displaced. So Archimedes, by Archimedes principle, like this. So can you see this? Can you see the picture here? Right. So there is a large transparent bucket like structure, and there is a nozzle outside, and the lady is, it's filled to the top. Okay, and then you request the lady to immerse her hand and upper limb up to the shoulder as much as you can, and then you measure the amount of water which is displaced, which comes out from the main bucket into the side beaker, and then you measure the volume of the water displaced. So volume displacement method, Archimedes principle basically. And so this is the considered a very precise method of measuring the volume of the limb. So more than 200 ml increase from the background, from the baseline pre-therapy value. And if you do not have pre-therapy value, more than 200 ml compared to the opposite size. Okay, normal, opposite being taken as normal. So this is one method. And then you can take limb circumference, and you should use a special tape, not an ordinary measuring tape that tailors use. So this is a specially designed tape for measuring the circumference of the limb, where there is a spring and there's a button. When you press this button, the tape automatically closes and closes like a ring around the limb. So like here, the lady's wrist circumference is being measured with this tape, and you take this measurement at predefined values. And so more than 2 centimeter increase in the girth, average increase in the girth from the pre-surgery value is also defined as lymphedema. So two definitions, either the volume or the diameter. Okay, 2 centimeter increase in diameter average or 200 ml. So they also measured other complications like seroma, surgical site infection, and of course, quality of life on a quality of life questionnaire, QOL. Quality of life measurement has now assumed great significance, great importance in today's research, mostly in cancer care and in other studies also. So, because whatever you do, you can cure a patient from cancer or another disease, but if quality of life is not good, then a patient continues to suffer. Okay, so quality of life must be better than the pre-therapy value in order to call that therapy as successful. So they had randomized 83 patients in this study, and half were randomized to receive penicillin at 3-weekly interval, and other half were just given advice regarding care of the limb, and then they were followed for 6 months to measure their diameter. And fortunately, in this study, for 6 months, there was no loss to follow up. And so they analyzed all 40 patients who were allocated and randomized to penicillin. 40 patients. So no patient was excluded from analysis. So can somebody tell what is this chart called? What is this chart called? We have to present the data in this.
Consort diagram.
What is this called?
Consort diagram.
Okay, so consort is a acronym, CONSORT. So who will tell me the full form of CONSORT?
There is a group
of doctors, scientists who met together, because you know previously what was happening, somebody will do a randomized trial and publish their results and not give all the parameters. Say they will not mention, it was a common place to not see how many were you know approached for eligibility of the study. They just mentioned we studied 83 patients. So whether if you approached 148 and could randomize 83, which is almost half or about 2/3, it's all right. But if you approach 1,000 and only 80 are randomized, so there is some problem. A lot of patients are not eligible. So your data is not being generalizable to the entire population of lymphedema. So there is some problem of generalizability. So it is very important to mention how many persons or patients were actually approached or considered for study, and then of whom, why so many were excluded. So as in this table, you get this flow diagram, it's called consort flow diagram. So the reason for exclusion must be given. They may not giving consent form, they are not meeting the inclusion criteria, you know, and so on. They are allergic to penicillin, they may not come for follow-up, they are come from different country. So multiple reasons, but you should mention all the reasons for exclusion, okay? And if exclusions are too many, then your data of your trial is not generalizable to the entire population of lymphedema. Okay, so this must be mentioned. So a group of doctors met together and they said, okay, we should have some well-defined parameter to say when we will call a study proper, and results of the randomized trial must be stated in a structured format. So consolidated reporting of randomized trial, CONSORT. CON is consolidated reporting, R is for reporting of randomized trial. Consolidated reporting of randomized trial. And if you go on website www.consort-hyphen statement, S-T-A-T-E-M-E-N-T, statement, .org. C-O-N-S-O-R-T, hyphen, statement, .org. So you will get a homepage of the consort, and they will introduce how it was started and history. And then there were two or three things. One is consort flow diagram, what is we are showing. Consort, this is called consort flow diagram. There is a consort checklist. And hello?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So consort flow diagram, what we are showing you today, and consort checklist, which shows whether how the randomization was done, whether allocation was blinded, and concealment, and assessment of the parameters. So it's a long checklist, okay? So that's called consort checklist and a consort flow diagram. So www.consort-statement. So whenever you do a study, mostly randomized trial, you must follow consort flow diagram, okay? And why we mention how many were randomized and how many were analyzed? Here, all 40 were analyzed. So there was no loss to follow, no exclusion. Suppose I exclude half. I randomize 40, but I analyze only 20. So what's the problem? 20 are either lost to follow up or for some reason they discontinue their therapy. So I do not analyze. I analyze only 20. So is there any problem? Hello?
Yes, sir. Yes.
The problem is of validity of the randomization process. The theory of randomization states that if we randomize the patients properly, especially if the randomized trial has a large sample, then the probability of distribution of the factors which determine the outcome, okay, which determine the outcome in the two groups will be equally distributed. Suppose I say that patients above 50 are more prone to get lymphedema. Suppose I say that obese patients are more prone. Suppose I say diabetics are more prone to have lymphedema. Suppose I say patients who already had filariasis have more chances. If they had tuberculosis of the axillary nodes. So all those factors which are likely to determine the outcome of lymphedema should be equally distributed in the two groups. And then only we can say, okay, the difference in the outcome in the my penicillin group compared to control group is only because of this penicillin and not due to other thing, not due to diabetes, not due to previous tuberculosis or previous filariasis and other factors. So the theory of randomization states that the two groups will have equal distribution of the known as well as unknown factors, known as well as unknown factor. That's the theory of randomization. Okay. So if you exclude, you have randomized on this theory that on this premise, that all the factors determining the outcome will be equally distributed in this group and this group. Okay. And later on you exclude some patient, you have violated that principle. Maybe that you have excluded those who had bad disease, who had more diabetes, who are more obese, who are more filaria and TB. So you have excluded all those bad people. So naturally the people who are left will not have or may not have that much lymphedema. So therefore, once allocated to a treatment or randomized for treatment, you should present the data of all those patients, okay? Whether they received or they did not receive. This is called intention to treat analysis. Intention to treat analysis, okay? So intention to treat analysis requires that you report the data of all the patients who are randomized to a particular group, okay? And if you fail, then you have violated the principle of intention to treat analysis. ITT is the short form, intention to treat analysis. Okay. Then we present the data of the baseline characteristics in the two groups. So all the factors like basic demographic characteristics like age, BMI, and limb volume here, whether they had diabetes or not, whether you did only breast conservation or full mastectomy. The studies have shown that patients undergoing mastectomy patients undergoing mastectomy have a higher chance of lymphedema compared to BCP. Whether they have axillary dissection or not, patients undergoing mastectomy have increased risk of lymphedema compared to BCP. Okay, all the studies have shown this. Patients who receive neoadjuvant therapy may have more chance, especially if the nodes were involved preoperatively, pre-therapy, and then you give chemotherapy, which causes death of the tumor cells in the axillary nodes. Death of these nodes by the chemotherapy will cause necrosis of the lymph nodes followed by fibrosis. So fibrosis of the lymph nodes will block the lymphatics. So patients receiving neoadjuvant chemotherapy will have more lymphedema, especially if the nodes were involved, okay, compared to those who do not receive. So these are the factors. So if your baseline, if your randomization was correct, then all these parameters at the baseline should be equally distributed in the two groups. So you can see age 50 here and 47, slightly less, but if there is no statistical difference, then it's just a biological variability. BMI should be nearly same, 25 here. Preoperative limb volume, 1578 ml here, 1436, slightly less. Diabetes 4 equal. Extent of breast surgery, BCT 87%, 86%, almost similar. 12% mastectomy, here 14% mastectomy. Slight difference may happen, especially if your sample size is small. If you take a very large sample, then all these parameters should be equally distributed. Okay? So that's the baseline characteristics. Now, our outcome was how many patients developed lymphedema. In this study, they reported the result at 6 months, but ideally we should follow for long period, up to 5 years. Because at 1 year, lymphedema may be more, and then gradually it goes down to a small percent in 5 years follow-up. As the collaterals develop, lymphedema goes down. So here they found that in the penicillin group, 5 ladies developed lymphedema compared to 10 ladies in the control arm. And so this was relative risk, relative probability or relative risk, 0.53. That is, risk of lymphedema was reduced to half, 0.5 is 50%. Probability of lymphedema was reduced to 50% in ladies who were receiving penicillin compared to the control group. And you can see one example here. This lady had this upper limb, right upper limb, was having axillary lymph node dissection, and she developed lymphedema. You can see the grossly swollen upper limb compared to the normal limb. So some of the symptoms of these ladies are that their bangles or, you know, chudi gala, and the rings, they become tighter on the lymphedema side. That's why they are advised not to wear any tight ring or tight bangle, and avoid also very tight clothes also on the operated side. Okay. Second outcome was lymphangitis and cellulitis. We'll call it lymphangitis because it's primary inflammation of the lymphatics, and cellulitis will follow if the inflammation bacteria come out and go into the diffuse spaces. Okay. So with inflammation, rubor, color, dolor, swelling of the limb, and pain and discomfort also in the lymphedematous limb. Please remember that a limb which is swollen, that is lymphedematous limb, is very prone to repeated episodes of infection and inflammation, mostly staphylococcal infection. Doctor, he has shown that low infection are very common, and that's why he recommends use of penicillin. And we were able in this randomized trial to show that the episodes of inflammation and infection indeed go down with 1 year of, and you can see it is only one patient out of 40 developed cellulitis compared to 9 patients in the cut. 1:9. So that's a ratio which is significant which is highly significant, and 88% of the cell prevented by giving 1 liter of penicillin, and this is called prevented fraction. Could be treated by compared to who did. Okay, so if you give penicillin, which so that the value, and you can tell to the your hospital administrator, look,
hello,
yes.
Hello, sir,
it's not audible.
Sir, video, okay, sir is locked out, I guess. Hello?
Screen now.
Yeah, sir, there was some problem with your connection. We could not hear you for the last 5 to 7 minutes.
Okay, so should I go back to this slide?
Yes, sir, please.
You all heard the allocation, the consort flow diagram?
Yes, sir.
Okay, then this slide?
No, sir.
This is done, sir. No.
Basically, we present the baseline characteristics in the two arm with the object of showing to the audience or to the readership that the factors which determine the outcome of disease are equally distributed in the two groups. If we know that is a factor, right? We should be able to show that age in the two groups was equally distributed, as here, you know.
Hello?
Obesity is it? Hello, can you see? Can you hear me?
Yes, sir. We are done with this slide. We were on the slide where infection and inflammation is to be.
Okay, lymphedema, occurrence of lymphedema was reduced to half, 0.5, that is 53%, in patients who received penicillin. 5 out of 35.
Preventive ratio 88%. Up to that we had discussed.
Okay. 5 out of 40 had lymphedema in penicillin group compared to 10 out of 43. Okay. So risk was reduced to half. Then cellulitis, the lymphangitis was again reduced to a very significant extent. Only one patient out of 40 developed cellulitis compared to 9 out of 43 developed in the group. Okay, so 1 upon 40 whole divided by 9 upon 43. So that gives you a risk ratio of 9, and that gives you a prevented fraction of 88. Prevented fraction is a quantity which gives you an idea how disease is prevented by a therapy would have occurred in the sense of. So when we say 88% were prevented, 8% is of lymphedema was prevented by giving 1 year of penicillin, which would have occurred if we had not given it. Okay, so it's a relative thing, and so 88% of the lymphedema. If in the current situation of say COVID infection, we can say wearing face shield along with an mask will prevent 88% of the coronavirus infection to the healthcare person. So if you do not wear face shield and N95, 88% will get of the doctors and nurses will get it, and wearing the face shield will be protected in 88%. So prevented fraction. Okay. Intervention studies, we use this term. In vaccination trials, you know, we use this term, prevented fraction. Now, surgical site infection. Surgical site means in the breast. In the breast, me or axillary dissection wound. Again, patients developed, not much difference, but slightly higher. And seroma was present in 6 out of 40 patients in the penicillin. And 7 out of 43.
Hello?
Slightly less in growth, probably due to less chance of infection, inflammation. And quality of life score 0.66 here and 0.6. Not much difference in the two groups.
Hello, sir?
Yeah.
Sir, the slides are zoomed in. Can you zoom out so we can see the entire slide?
Zoom out. Can you see now? Can you see it now?
No, we can only see a part of the slide.
So you'll have to unshare and reshare again.
No, it's happening now.
Can you see the whole slide now?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. We can see it now.
Yeah? Okay.
Yes.
You could see this slide now?
Yes, sir.
Okay. And the previous one? Yes?
Yes, sir.
Is the whole slide visible?
Yes, sir. It's visible.
Yes. Okay. Right. So we could prevent a lot of cellulitis and lymphedema by giving this penicillin. So that's a very interesting, very affordable and safe way of preventing lymphedema. And other complications were not much affected except for anesthesia, paresthesia, which were also less in the penicillin group compared to the control. And quality of life score, again, relative risk 0.23. which means significant improvement in quality of life score. Okay, so if you take all patients who had surgical site infection present, absent, patients who have lymphedema, you have increased chance of repeated attacks of infection and inflammation. And a lot of studies have shown this. It is thought that the fluid, lymphedema fluid, has some factor which cannot prevent the spread of bacteria. So normal tissue fluid has some antibacterial or anti-staphylococcal and streptococcal substance, and the edema fluid lacks that ability. So whenever there is lymphedema, edema, they are like have repeated attacks of cellulitis and lymphangitis. So this is known whenever there is lymphedematous limb, particularly lower limb, very commonly, regardless of the cause, whether it is post DVT or post filariasis, these lymphedematous swelling swollen limbs are Hello. Is this a problem?
Yes, sir.
Yes?
No, sir. Please continue.
Okay. So, we analyzed the results in relation to lymphedema. So, patients who had lymphedema, okay, many of them, 11 out of... proves the point that most of the swollen 15 also to get repeat attacks of infection and inflammation. Okay. So we can conclude this study by saying that the presence of seroma and presence of surgical site infection and cellulitis are strong predictors for different lymphedema. Many studies have shown this, and you can prevent all these by giving 3-weekly injection of benzathine penicillin after sensitivity test for 1 year, and very safe and affordable treatment. So this study that Dr. Anita had done. Dr. Anita, are you connected?
Hello. Yes, sir. Good evening, sir.
Good evening. So would you like to share your experience? Dr. Anita is a professor in her department, and she does a lot of vascular surgery and special operations for lymphedema here. So I now invite Dr. Anita Dhar in the platform to tell you more about lymphedema.
Good evening, everyone.
Learning about, so she is the master of lymphedema care. So Dr. Anita, please.
Sir has already given you most of the highlighted points, and the frequency, whether we do full ALND. Am I audible to all?
Yes, ma'am, audible.
And whether we do ALND and to some extent, almost 5% in SLNB patients, also it has been shown that there is lymphedema. So it's better, as they say, prevention is better than cure. So we start with prevention. We do the prevention part, and as the study, infection an important element in development of chronic lymphedema. First acute and then the chronic episodes. We can start with the prophylactic penicillin before even incision of the mastectomy or SLNB. So it has given us good results. Why all this is possible, that we have concluded through this study that seroma, SSI, cellulitis, all of them, they are contributory factors for development of lymphedema. Therefore, it's an attempt to prevent it. And we have also
Anita, can I just request you to show some slides? You can come into the Zoom and share your, if your computer is on, and show your presentation. It's available.
So presentation slide, most of the slides. Sir, can you open that third presentation? Lymphedema.
Okay.
2016 lymphedema. There are certain slides in that. Upper arm, sir, is shown before the intervention part and post-intervention.
Okay.
So there is one lymphedema 2016 presentation.
Yes, I got it.
There are certain pictures, sir. They can, because you have a direct link now, sir.
Okay, sure.
So through those slides, sir, we can show them actually.
Can you see this screen?
Not yet, sir.
No? How to share this?
Sir, lower down, there is a green button, share screen.
No, how to, first I have to download it?
Yes.
So you please open it like a PPT.
Open. Okay. Like
and the way you are presenting, sir, that can go.
Okay. I'll open and then you can speak.
Yes, sir.
So thank I can you, go on, sir, while you're opening it.
Go on.
The worst form, what we have seen in the clinics, is not the look. We can see the outside look of the patient having a lymphedema arm in post-mastectomy. The most vulnerable part is the weight of that arm. It's so heavy that patients cannot even lift it to even comb their hair. They cannot even do day-to-day personal hygiene or day-to-day activities at home or whatever, writing and all. That is something very troublesome, the weight of the limb. And size itself is there, but somehow the ladies are not bothered for the size, but the weight. the minute the weight goes out, you take out the water from that limb, that they'll be able to use that limb. That's so, they're so happy with it. So how do we do it? Since the lymphatics are blocked, there is a lot of cellulitis. If you see these ladies, they have episodes of redness on their skin. They will say, I have episodes of red color. And they have sometimes fever. These episodes, they are typical of dermatolymphangioadenitis, DLA. Recurrent attacks of DLA will finally bring chronicity. The acute episodes will finally land up in chronic form of this lymphangitis and the stasis, because even if few lymphatics that were open earlier, because of these recurrent episodes, that also they get blocked. And the patient goes in a chronic state. It's very difficult to bring out that patient from a chronic state. So the most important thing is to take care of the infection, take care of their skin. A small scratch of the skin can be a portal of entry of infection for these ladies. Since it's already stasis and there is no exit for such a bacterial infection, they land up having a florid type of infection. So that is DLA. So you have to target first the organism, treat that, and also at the same time give something that can be a long-term benefit for them. For example, it has been already talked to you, like a benzathine penicillin preparation. That works in a slow form throughout day and night for them. Benzathine penicillin is safe. It doesn't have side effects. And it has been found it does not have resistance. That's the most beautiful part of this medicine. It has no resistance. Till now, they have not found any resistance to this drug. So it works for them. The episodes of lymphangitis decreases over a period of time. The skin starts healing. When the acute episode that patient has presented with that settles, you can add skin care. You can add compression. Compression can be in the form of compression bandaging, or it can be compression through machines. Am I audible? Hello?
Yes, ma'am. You're audible.
So compression can be in two forms, right? If you have a compression therapy machine, whatever chamber, number of chambers it has, now the more advanced form of machines are available where there are 12 chambers. It sends a beautiful ripple from periphery to the trunk of the body. So trunk, which takes away the fluid. Then there is manual lymphatic drainage. It works in the same form. And then you can put them on short stretch bandages. Short stretch bandages can be worn day and night. There is no hesitation for that. When the edema decreases and the weight has come down, start them on exercises. Exercise forms a very, very important component to treat such patients. So it's, to summarize, it's a multimodality treatment. Everything just submits, gives some benefit to the patient. Right? And during day, if it's a lady who has to go out, she cannot handle too much of bandaging and all, once the girth, the weight has decreased, she can wear a sleeve, compression sleeve, graduated compression sleeve, and go out for the day. When she comes back, she can wear this compression bandage, which can be carried on throughout the night till she has to take a bath or do something. And then there are a lot of people, the early phase of the lymphedema people, they do respond. They respond very well. Then they have to maintain this. Maintenance part is irrespective of whether you do a medical treatment, do surgical treatment, whatever form of treatment, but this medical treatment has to go on. It's an adjuvant therapy on top of whatever else you can do for these patients. Right. Then we come to more resistant form of treatment. When there is a lot of fibrosis, there's no choice of such type of medical treatment to help them. There are ways, people have tried different methods. People have tried nodal transfers so that the lymphatic fluid, there are pools and lakes of fluid there that can be drained in different form. And one of them, which we have done a trial, is putting artificial lymphatic channels. Artificial lymphatic channels in the form of silicon tubes, which are fenestrated. They have a caliber of almost 3 millimeter. We put three such
tubes. Excuse me, Dr. Anita, I have got your slides. So,
sir, you can show the pictures. So pictures can be nice for them.
This picture?
No, sir. Clinical pictures, sir.
Okay.
There are some post-mastectomy clinical pictures.
Can you see this? Can you see the slides?
Yes, sir. I can see this.
You can see this?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so you can read this. Can everybody see the slides? Please check.
Yes, sir. We can see them.
Okay. Yes, sir.
So there are certain pictures post-mastectomy. They can appreciate the difference in the size of the limb, sir. The slides are not moving, sir.
Can you see the slides?
Yes, sir.
There's a slide showing lymphatic graft harvesting from patient. Can you see this slide?
Yes.
Can everybody see this slide?
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Yeah, this is the different, there are the different ways of using lymphatics for reconstruction. This is how the end lymphatics from the upper arm are connected with the proximal ones. These are different ways of doing lymphatic anastomosis. So next.
Yes. Can you see this microsurgical lymphovenous shunt?
Yes, sir.
Lymphovenous anastomosis.
So there are the different varieties. You use a very high end electron microscope to see these lymphatics, which has a very small caliber. Then there are nodo-venous shunts, where you drain the static nodes into the lymphatic channels. That can be, part of the node can be put inside it, or the side to side of the node, slice the node, open the inside, and anastomose it with the cut end of the venous channel. That is the nodo-venous shunt. That can be tried. People have tried various methods to do. People have even tried during ALND anastomosing the channels, thinking that the lymphedema will be prevented. So they are actually very high and challenging procedures, because operating on very fine lymphatic channels, which are not even dilated at that point of time, is actually very challenging surgery. These are node to venous anastomosis in the different form. Next, sir.
Can you see the next slide?
These are the clinical pictures of anastomosing the cut end of the node. You have to be very careful. The proximal afferent nodes, the lymphatics that come to the node, they are to be preserved while we are exposing the node for anastomosis. So we should not be destroying those incoming lymphatics. And then we expose this, and the adjoining vein, which is next to possibly good caliber vein, we can open it on one side and anastomose it with the do a nodo venous shunt. This is the operative pictures of that. Next, sir. So there are some post mastectomy pictures.
Okay. Silicone lymphatic. You want to tell something about silicone tubing?
Yeah, I was talking about this only. These are the artificial lymphatics. They are fenestrated. I talked about it. They are 3 millimeter size. We use 3 of them, starting from the dorsum of the hand. They go in the subcutaneous plane. That means outside the defacia, between skin and defacia. That's the level where actually the lymphatics is blocked. It's not inside the defacia. You can see it because there are certain, for example, the wrist area, there's a like a sleeve constricting effect. Then you can see the hump of the dorsum of hand. It's because the defacia is not touched. It's outside the defacia. So you tend to put these channels, 3 of them together, fenestrated finally from dorsum of the hand, putting an incision at the dorsum just above the wrist, and then railroading these 3 channels, tubings, silicone tubings, subcutaneously going from dorsum along the forearm, behind the elbow, then up in the upper arm, and finally the landing zone of, or the terminal part of these tubes is the shoulder. Shoulder, because that is a neat virgin area. The whole, in fact, the upper arm is edematous. We are talking about the arms that are refractory. No treatment possible, maybe the late presentations and all. And the shoulder is spared. So you take these lymphatic channels from dorsum of the hand to the shoulder, thinking that this is going to drain from the dorsum along the whole arm, length of the arm, and finally drain into the shoulder area at the scapular region. We have to, in follow-up, be careful, because finally you are draining a stagnant lymphatic water fluid, which is teemed with bacteria, which is teemed, infected. And you have to keep a close watch on the drainage area, that is in the scapular region. Sometimes patients may develop cellulitis in that area, because you get the infected lymphatic fluid may get pooled there. So the most important part is keep a vigil on these patients. It's not that we have done something and we just forget about it. So we have to keep a watch, and as I said, the compression on all has to continue. Patient has to be on antibiotics. You cannot leave them only with these tubings. And we have done it in the lower limbs also, and it has given us good results. And there are a few slides. So may I request you to move on with the slides?
Okay. Yeah. You want to explain this? Lymphoscintigraphy?
Yeah, there is...
Give the theory part.
This is the lower limb actually. In this you can see, this is one of the patient, the clinical image is also in this, and which one limb was quite big, swollen, and there was a lot of stagnation in the inguinal region. And we did a nodal venous shunt for that patient, and the images are in this, sir. If we can see the clinical image.
Next one.
Yeah, this is how these lymphatic tubings are placed. This is this patient. And pre-operative view of the limb, lower limb. Next, sir, please.
Next.
This is how you can see it on the left side. This is before surgery, and the right side is after surgery. You can see the size, how it has decreased. This is post nodal venous shunt. Sir, next, please.
From here to here. See, magic. You know, you have done magic.
This is one of the lady who has come after post-mastectomy, and where axillary dissection, full axillary dissection was, lymph nodal dissection was done. And she had ignored it for a long time. And the most important complaint was, I cannot lift my arm. It was so heavy. She was not bothered about the size. but the weight of that limb was so heavy. These are the pre-op images, and you can see the left, you can see the absent breast, left breast, and the limb, left limb is swollen. This is the dorsum of the hand, and you can see the side view, how the forearm is swollen. As I said, there is this demarcation at the wrist level because the skin gets ballooned up. The deep fascia does not. Deep fascia is normal. It's the outside of the deep fascia that gets pooled with the lymphatic fluid. Sir, we can have next slide, please. This is how we place silicone tubes for this lady. We can call it as artificial lymphatic channels. This is the process of different steps. We use a tunneler and make three incisions, one at the above, just above the wrist, second is medial side of the elbow, and third one is the scapular region. And we use a tunneler to move across these lymphatic channels in the space, subcutaneous space. Next, please, sir. Now, these are the images before and after the surgery. I have written here before and next is after. Now you can see the difference in the size. You can see the lateral view and the direct view also, how the fluid has come out. And this lady was really happy because the weight of the limb decreased. And she could use her limb after years of struggle. And that really brought smile to her. This is the another patient. So we can see the clinical images. Next, sir. This is one more patient. This is an example of lower limb, nodovenous shunt, how it has decreased and the ulcer has also healed after doing the nodovenous shunt, the compression therapy, medical treatment with benzathine penicillin, and treating the infection. Please do not forget, then there is an ulcer, there is infection along with it. We have to actively treat it. Give good antibiotics, not for 4 days, 5 days. You may even have to give it for as long as 2 weeks, 3 weeks. They are deemed chronically infected patients. So it takes a while for them to get healed.
Next.
This is one more example. You can see it was a very interesting result. And it's the same patient. You have to believe this. And it really helped. It really helped this patient.
Nodovenous
shunt was done for this patient. Yes, sir.
So just tell them, you know, the principles. So when do you do nodovenous? When do you do lymphaticovenous? And when do you put the silicone tubings?
Silicone tubings is the last resort, sir, when there is, they are not treatable with any means. Even if a nodovenous shunt fails, then we can try that's a last resort to put silicone tubes. Placing of silicone tubes is not the first choice. If the lymphedema is in the early stages, we can always treat them by compression and the medical treatment. Most of the lymphatic lymphedema settles, and of course with the prophylaxis of antibiotic. But patients who are resistant to all this, we can try other methods. And if the lymphatic, the nodovenous shunt is, the nodes are blocked there, we have a choice and we can do a nodovenous shunt. But there are patients who have a lot of fibrosis and these procedures, they don't work. Nodes are fibrosed. And they say that even if they are fibrosed, if you open that groin area or the axillary area, that also helps sometimes in drainage of this lymphatic lymph rather. And then the choices are limited later on. When most of the limb has fibrosis, the choices are very limited. Then you can try these artificial lymphatics. And the most important thing is that you have to be very vigilant in these cases. They should not be neglected because you're putting a foreign body, and you have to be careful that they put compression bandaging along with it, because they don't have a pump. These lymphatics, they drain, but something has to push that. And the bandaging is very, very important in these cases. And as I said, the point is they are draining infected lymph, and you have to be they have to be on regular antibiotics, and you have to keep on checking their exit point. The exit point should not have cellulitis, it should not be infected, because if we ignore that, patient can have even septicemia, because they are bad limbs with
infected fluid, infected with fluid going into the veins. So it causes septicemia and bacteremia.
We have to be very, very vigilant about it.
So, Professor Anita, if you will see the pre-operative lymphoscintigraphy, and if lymphatics are dilated, then going up to the, say, groin in the lower limb or up to axilla in the upper limb, you will try to anastomose these lymphatics to a nearby node if present, or to a vein if nodes have been removed by a
blade. So we have to do it with the vein. First? That is the first vein. So first
after
of
ALND,
all, we don't...
After
we
ALND, don't, when the nodes are out, you will use a vein, lymphaticovenous.
So the surgical procedure is not the first choice.
The first conservative? Choice,
yes, sir. First choice is always, always giving antibiotics, compression, exercise, skin care. And then when this intense phase is over, then only we see which cases have responded, because there are certain patients who are defaulters. They don't do it regularly. So we had to, the group activities we follow sometimes. Sometimes the patients, they can pick up quickly how to do bandaging. And we have used a Pico press to check the sub-bandage pressure, because the bandages can get loosened and the pressures, they go off. So we have to teach these patients how to do an optimal bandaging to maintain that pressure, sub-bandage pressure. And for our understanding, we use Pico press to understand. We send the patient with the first bandage, and that there's a sensor that we left under this near the, just above the ankle, and we send them home. And then we call them after 24 hours, and we found what is the pressure once again. And many patients, they had a slide down or loosening of the bandage. Then we keep on teaching them. And the most important thing is, if we do all this in groups, they help each other, they teach each other, the relatives get involved. It's a very wonderful thing to see them, how they help each other. That's how they learn. There are people who picked up this bandaging so fast, and it's not a very difficult learning process, and they do understand how much pressure we have to apply, and that gives them benefit. And penicillin, for example, there are patients, sometimes the supply of penicillin was short in market, and we have a lot of patients, they came and they were so much disturbed that we're not getting this penicillin. Why? Because the episodes of lymphangitis had decreased tremendously. We are using it for chronic venous ulcers also. We are doing a trial on that also. They are so happy. The healing of the venous ulcers has helped a lot in these patients. We have a randomized trial. It's finished just recently, and it has proved very beneficial. And the recurrence of the ulcers has decreased. That's true for upper limb also. These patients have decreased number of episodes of lymphangitis. That is actually the crux, because they get recurrent episodes that leaves them in a chronic state. And once they enter in that very chronic state, it's very difficult to treat that. So we have to be, very active from day one, and teach them how to do exercises before you do the mastectomy and ALND of these patients. Spend time with them, counsel them, and tell them what can happen later on. it's not that you want to just protect yourself. No, it's to help them. If you teach them exercises much before you put a knife on them for mastectomy or ALND, that's the best time, because they don't have pain at that time. The acceptance, the way they do the shoulder exercises, the day they handle the skin and all, they can accept it. They know they can do it. And after surgery, when the pain factor goes, they know it, they have done it. So they are confident, yes, we can do it. And gradually, they start doing it. And even if it's in a compromised form because of the pain and all, but they have learned how to do it. That's the best time to actually teach, before surgery. And
you want to say something about this lymphoscintigraphy picture you are showing here? Partial lymphatic obstruction. Can you see this picture?
Yes, sir. The patients who have a partial, lymphatic blockade, they are the patients who actually benefit from surgery also. And if we do a nodovenous shunt in such patients, the tissues are soft. When the tissues are soft, they recover very fast. This is one more patient. You can see this is the pre-op picture on the left side. And he is wearing the same pant actually post-operatively also. This he had designed for himself, and he could cover the whole limb. You can see the big size of this pant. Coincidentally, he came in the same pant, and we took a photograph, and you can see the difference in the limb now. Earlier, it was fitting the whole this sleeve or whatever. So that's how
the you can save the clothes. So clothing can also be. So that's another advantage of your surgery, lymph node, nodovenous sinus. Reduce the cost of the cloth. I think
the main points are, we have already covered the main points.
Okay. I'll just show some more slides.
Yes, sir.
This one.
These are all clinical pictures.
Silicone. These are silicone tubings. So if you cannot see any lymphatics and nodes are destroyed, then this is the last resort, putting silicone tubing or artificial lymphatics, as Dr. Anita calls them. And they are specially designed silicone tubings from Poland by Dr. Olszewski's group. So they are porous and they have multiple holes. Like you have several holes on the side of Ryle's tube or side of your intestinal decompressor, you know, Savage intestinal decompressor. So multiple holes, so that if one gets blocked, the other will open. And but you continue to have conservative treatment in the form of
that's very important. Hygiene, yes. The treatment part is very important, medical treatment.
And long-term antibiotics. Do you put them on oral antibiotics also for long-term?
Oral is given, yes, sir.
Or penicillin is sufficient.
We give simple Ceptran after silicone placement and along with benzathine penicillin, sir.
Cotrimoxazole, long-term. Cotrimoxazole, yes, is an anti-MRSA antibiotic. So it is a list of anti-MRSA antibiotics, and cotrimoxazole is one of them. So you can put them. And the good thing about cotrimoxazole or Ceptran is that many general practitioners or doctors don't use it. It's not in fashion these days. So resistance to cotrimoxazole is very less. So you can use it for long term. That's it. Anything else you want to tell? There's a last thing. What is an ideal procedure?
That's a last slide, sir.
You can summarize beautifully here.
We have talked about most of the things, sir. The most important thing is prevent infection. We have demonstrated in what sir already has presented the trial. We have demonstrated that infection plays a very important role. No doubt, the removal of the lymph nodes and the radiotherapy that follows it also is very, they are important factors. But on top of that, if the infection, if we can prevent surgical site infection, seroma formation, necrosis, they are all responsible for chronicity and bringing in of the lymphedema. And to a large extent, wherever it's possible to do neat surgeries and give treatment along with it so that the infection is prevented.
Thank you, Dr. Anita. Beautifully summarized and presented. And it's really remarkable what you have achieved in patients where nothing else could be done. And so patients were so much frustrated that they designed their own clothing to manage their life.
One more thing, sir. So, taking blood pressure, telling them not to use the arm and all. There are a lot of myths and we scare them not to even use the limb. See, what happens? They take a thought home and the relatives also keep on telling them kuch nahi karna hai, haath nahi lagana hai. They become so much disabled without reason. So we have to be careful in telling them, look, they should not injure the skin. That is the most important thing. They should protect their hand. They should not burn it. They should not put injections. Blood pressure is not a problem. Taking blood pressure on that limb, it's a short duration compression, which we otherwise also give. That is not a contraindication. And they should use it. They should use the limb. Exercise and weightlifting, there are certain trials where even weightlifting, it has been shown that lymphedema was a plus point for them to decrease the lymphedema. So that is most important. They have to use the limb. And that will help in drainage, further drainage of the limb. It's not, please don't tell them, don't use the arm. Use it, but carefully, not injure the skin. As sir says, go for gardening, wear a good protected gloves, and even kitchen gloves is available so they can protect their hand. That's it, sir.
Thank you. So a quiz question is, who was the surgeon who advised his wife, who was a scrub nurse, to wear kitchen glove or gardener's glove? Name the surgeon who advised his wife, who was a scrub nurse with him, to wear the kitchen gloves or gardener's glove.
William Halstead.
William Halstead. Thank you. And his wife was a scrub nurse. And in those days, this is 1880 something, where the doctors, before operating, they had to wash their hands with phenol, carbolic acid, right? And carbolic acid is a very strong irritant. And ladies' skin is so delicate, you know. So she used to get a burn, you know, chemical burn on her hands. So to protect her wife's hands, Dr. Halstead said, why don't you wear these gardener's gloves? So this was the beginning of wearing gloves for surgery. Before that, surgeons were operating without wearing gloves. So Dr. William Halstead is said to have started wearing, latex or rubber gloves for the first time in operating theater. And which company manufactured these gloves for Dr. Halstead? Dunlop or Goodyear? It's Goodyear, I think. Goodyear. The tire company. Goodyear. Right. Next quiz question is, who started the use of phenol or carbolic acid as antiseptic in surgery? He is called the father of antisepsis or father of
Lister.
Joseph Lister. Who on 12th August 1865. In those days, 1865 around, it was the rule that if a person comes with compound fracture of the lower limb, tibia and fibula, both open compound fracture, they had to do amputation. Why? Because otherwise, all patients with compound fracture of lower limb were followed by gangrene of the lower limb and they will die of gas gangrene. So to prevent that, they used to do amputation. So this young boy called James came to the surgeon, Dr. Lister. Young boy. So Dr. Lister said to sister that, look, the limb seems all right. So let us dress it with carbolic acid. So he applied carbolic acid dressing. And 2 days later, when the dressing was removed, there was no infection, no pus, no gangrene. So in those days, in the English, infection was called festering, F-E-S-T-E-R-I-N-G. So Dr. Lister said to sister, look, there is no festering of the wound. So we can use carbolic acid for prevention of infection. And this is how antisepsis was born. 12th August 1865, Dr. Joseph Lister of Edinburgh. Thank you very much. If there are any questions or comments, I saw Dr. Prabal Neoiki, a famous surgical teacher from MLN Medical College, Allahabad.
Sir, I'm listening with great intent, and thank you. Excellent talk by yourself and Dr. Anita, whom I haven't met, of course.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Very good. I'm very impressed with the results.
Thank you. If there are any other questions or comments, please do share. There's a lot of lymphedema, not just after breast surgery, but also a lower limb infection due to blister. Filaria in UP, in Bihar, in Tarai area, in Odisha, East, you know, Odisha, coastal areas. Yes. So we can do a lot.
Absolutely.
By, you know, taking care of these edematous limbs.
Absolutely, sir. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you. Namaskar.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Sir, good evening, sir.
Good evening. Yes, please.
Sir, Vishwachandra, sir. So I have a few questions.
Yes, please.
So with regarding the benzathine penicillin as a prophylactic.
Just speak a bit louder, please.
Sir, regarding this prophylactic dose of benzathine penicillin.
Yeah, 12 units, 3 weekly.
Yes, sir. Would you advise to give in all cases of ALND or to selected patients who had neoadjuvant chemo or higher BMI or extensive lymph node dissection, or in whom we expect RT to axilla, they may warrant? Like, have you got any selected patients for whom we give this prophylactic dose of benzathine penicillin, or to all patients who undergo this procedure?
In these 80 patients, we gave to all. We did not select them because we did not know initially which patient will benefit the most. So we gave it to all, and we know, of course, from the background knowledge from literature that obese patients are more at risk. If you give axillary dissection followed by radiotherapy, you have more risk. If you get infection in the limb, you have more risk. But penicillin is such a safe drug. It costs 12 rupees. 12 rupees one vial. And anaphylaxis to benzathine penicillin is almost unknown. Dr. Olszewski, our visiting surgeon from Poland, he is 87 years old now. And he says in his last 55 years of his surgical career, he has never seen a case of anaphylaxis of benzathine penicillin. So it is overstated in pharmacology books that penicillin will cause anaphylactic reaction and death. Minor reaction can happen in the form of some urticaria or rash. But death, I mean, he says he has never seen anaphylaxis. And I've never seen, I'm 64, I've never seen anaphylaxis due to penicillin. So it is probably overstated. And all the doctors and nurses are frightened by the name penicillin. I will not give because of risk of infection, risk of reaction. But I think we should use it more commonly. And it is such a safe drug. And as Dr. Anita emphasized that the staphylococci and streptococci almost never develop resistance to this low dose penicillin. One reason may be that you need to give high doses continuously for any bacteria or virus to develop resistance. There's some genetic mutation, there's some DNA or RNA change which makes the bacteria or virus resistant to a particular antimicrobial. Because we are giving it 3 weekly and such a low dosage, probably germs are not allowed to develop resistance.
And as you and madam pointed out, we do have the shortage of benzathine penicillin. So do you suggest any alternate drugs, sir, for this?
Oral penicillin is also available, you know, potassium penicillin, penicillin V it is called.
V.
So for children, for children, they use this oral penicillin tablets. for prevention of rheumatic fever. Mm-hmm. You know, children who have rheumatic fever, you can't give too many injections. So children are given syrup or tablets of potassium penicillin V. So that is alternative.
Okay. You can also give, sir, amoxicillin and clavulanic acid, 2 grams
very good.
For 3 days every 2 to 3 weeks. That is also a known alternate, sir.
Yes, penicillin. So some form of penicillin. Thank you. Any other
questions?
Good evening, sir.
Yeah,
good evening.
Sir, a couple of questions.
Please.
One is that if for the conservative measures, they say that we don't use compressive therapy and elastic bandages for a patient with peripheral vascular disease with an ABPI of less than 0.5. So then what will be our approach for such patients? How would we tackle lymphedema in such patients?
Dr. Anita?
See, you cannot use a very...
Lymphedema with arterial disease. Severe 0.5 ABPI, ankle brachial pressure index, means severe critical ischemia. 0.5 is critical ischemia, Dr. Anita. Is that right?
That's true. That's a critical limb ischemia, which actually you cannot measure. You have, I don't know whether you have a patient with this or you cannot measure.
If your
patient
has... Theoretical.
Yeah, it's theoretical because you cannot measure it if patient has a lymphedema. And we are very careful whenever we subject patient to such therapies. It is our protocol to evaluate their veins and arteries before we set them to any sort of compression. We follow this protocol very carefully. And even for because lymphedema is there and under... Patient can also have the venous edema. You never know. Patient may be having a chronic DVT, which may be overlapping, or patient may be having atherosclerotic disease and having blocked vessels. We can't even feel their pulses. So definitely, yes, your question is valid. 0.5 critical limb ischemia, it falls in that category. It's a hypothetical question, may not present. But yes, atherosclerotic changes will be there. We have to rule it out. We have to be careful when you are doing compression bandage in such patients. It has to be a very mild bandage. We should not harm the circulation of the patient. Yes, it's a very important question and we take care of it when we do practically, we treat these patients. We have an arterial Doppler already done scan for these patients to take care of the pressures. So, and another thing is manual lymphatic drainage. That is another choice if you are very, you're scary of putting bandage. So manual lymphatic drainage is a well-known procedure which can be tried.
So besides this, if you have a patient who has swollen limb and his he has arterial disease as well, number one, with a critical limb ischemia, ankle brachial pressure index of 0.5, number one, admit the patient. Right, whatever day or night of the time, admit the patient. Find some bed for him or her in the hospital. It's very important. Otherwise, yes. Patient may lose the limb. Number two, heparin. Start heparin. If you have ordinary sodium
it
heparin,
it was a hypothetical. Sir, yeah, it was a hypothetical question. Patient will definitely have other symptoms if patient has 0.5 ABPI.
So give heparin. If you have sodium heparin, just give sodium heparin 10,000 loading dose. Followed by 5,006 hourly, or if you have low molecular weight heparin, enoxaparin, clexane, or some other form, start. And third is elevate the limb. Elevate the limb, because with a swollen limb, measurement of the...
Sir, elevation should not be allowed.
No elevation?
No elevation, sir. Keep the limb straight, because elevation, it's already a compromised circulation. So we'll not elevate the limb.
Okay. So how will get the swelling down? Because you cannot apply crompt bandage also.
So that's what I said. We can do manual lymphatic drainage. We can put patient on antibiotics. And we can use a very gentle
and
soft...
And heparin.
Patient heparin will definitely have other symptoms if it's 0.5 ABPI. He has put a hypothetical
situation. Arrange color Doppler to evaluate the, you know, and get a vascular surgeon to see. Because if there is a block or there is a embolism... You can do some vascular intervention by an experienced vascular surgeon to save the limb. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, ma'am. Two more questions. One was that we've couple of times we've had in our emergency surgery room that we've had patients with lymphedema presenting with necrotizing fasciitis, like neglected infection proceeding with necrotizing fasciitis. So we've done radical debridements for them too, but then the results post debridement are not very great in them. Then how should we approach patients?
Dr. Anita, any comments on this?
The necrotizing fasciitis itself, you said you had to do extensive debridement. And as I said, follow the protocol, see their veins, arteries. If arteries, there is a good arterial flow, and you have to take out the lymphatic fluid from rest of the limb. Of course, do a serial debridement till all the dead tissue is out of that limb and see how much defect is later on. And follow the tissue cultures. We do not send swabs. We stop sending swabs for wounds. We take small tissue and send it for culture. Follow the cultures and treat the infection. That goes without saying. You have to treat the infection before you move on to the second step. Protect this, take good wound care. Once you think that wound, all the dead tissue has come out, subject this patient, if the arteries are normal, elevate the limb. Elevation is the best thing. Put the limb as high as possible if the arterial circulation is good. Use compression bandaging. It should be a short stretch compression bandage that will help in taking out the fluid. That's very important. Once the fluid comes out, you'll see that healing also is better. And then either you are as a surgeon or a plastic surgeon can judge how much is the raw area left. By then, you'll see the wound healing with good granulation tissue. If the infection is under control, how much area is there beneficial, whether the bones are exposed or not, and so many different things to judge whether he needs a free flap or he needs a skin graft later on. That can be always assessed in the days to come.
Thank you, Dr. Anita. Thank you. Any other question or comment, please?
Regarding the compression garments, would you suggest a routine crib bandage or the compressive stockings type for the arm?
Sir, I have already said, if patient has no lymphedema, we use prophylactic compression sleeve. And if patient has lymphedema, we use compression bandages. We use, of course, first antibiotics to treat infection. Once we see in weeks times or 10 days time, the skin has color has settled nice, the infection has settled, we put these patients on compression bandage. Because forming a compression sleeve in the beginning is like it will be loosened after some time. So do not tell them to make a compression sleeve in the beginning. Put them on compression bandage, preferably a short stretch one. And once the edema settles, and when you think that now it's a static thing, its maximum results have been achieved, then you can ask for measurements and then make a good compression sleeve for the patient. And that can be worn during day. As I said, once the patient has to go out to office or do work, and then patient can come back home and wear a nice short stretch bandage that can be left during night also. That can be beneficial. That means you're protecting and giving care throughout the day and night to this patient.
Thank you, Professor Anita. Do not prefer
compression sleeve in the beginning because the size, the girth of the limb changes in days, following days, because you are working on decreasing the lymphedema. So the size will change. So you should always ask for the sleeve formation or the measurements later on when you think it's a static limb now.
Thank you, ma'am.
Good evening, ma'am.
Very well said. Very well explained, Professor Anita. Any other question, please?
Ma'am, with the current advances in lymphatic surgery, is there any place for the conventional surgeries which we've read about, like cyst trunk operation and Homan's operation, which used to modify the subcutaneous and the skin tissue in fibrotic limbs?
I don't know how many of us are actually doing it now. Very less, because see, the concepts are changing. When the concepts change, you treat these patients in a different way. For example, the pictures that we have shown, the huge big limb, lower limb, having a huge big that ballooned up leg. Will you like to do a Strang's operation and all in the beginning? No, I will not. With the knowledge now that you have to treat infection, you have to do compression, you have a good alternate choice, I will go for it first. And the whatever residual tissue left, which is fibrosed or distorted, and then we can have some cosmetic choice for them later on. I will not prefer to do surgery, this type of surgery, in the beginning. I will not do it.
Thank you, Professor Anita. Any other comments?
One last question. That, ma'am, after inguinal lymph node dissection, if there is a persistent lymph output in the drain, which is not reducing, how should we go about the persistent lymphatic leak that is taking place?
We don't put drains there. We make a nodovenous shunt or lymphatic shunt. Nobody puts drains in that area. And that is taken care of. There is no oozing from it. And you seal the wound. It's a very small incision, hardly 2 centimeters incision, because you plan your incision in such a way that it's right on top of, below the crease and medial to the artery, where you can find the vein, you can find the venous branches and the lymphatics also, they travel, they are everywhere, they are along the venous channels. So you have to plan for your incision. Do not give a very big incision, very small, 2 centimeters hardly, or 3 centimeters maximum. And you seal it, completely close it. You close it in layers and it heals properly. I have not found any lymphatic drainage or oozing from that.
Ma'am, actually for malignancies, when we do inguinal lymph node dissections, at times sometimes people leave a small, a single limb of a Romsen's drain or a vacuum suction drain post-op.
Yes, yes.
So from that side, if there is a persistent lymph leak which is present, which is not reducing on conservative...
You just have to wait and watch. You have to be careful. Example, for example, for penile cancers, for other malignancies, we do it. But be careful that the skin is closed properly. The skin should heal. What happens if you don't close the skin properly and there's skin necrosis? It keeps on oozing from the main wound. That is very bad then. So be careful to close the skin. The suture line should heal properly. And then if you leave this drain for some time, it should not matter. Even if it drains for some time and you should cover it with an antibiotic, it decreases of its own. It doesn't last, I mean, for a long time then. The most important thing is prevent surgical site infection, the necrosis of the flap, disruption of the wound, that complicates the whole thing. And the wound gets infected inside, then the lymph is draining, which is infected. It doesn't work that way. So one has
and
to
please, for God's sake, use subcuticular sutures, not interrupted nylon or interrupted silk or any interrupted staple. Use subcuticular sutures with the absorbable monofilament sutures such as polyglycaperon or polydioxanone, preferably triclosan antimicrobial coated sutures such as Monocryl Plus 30 or PDS Plus 30. So they will reduce the infection. And with subcuticular suture, the epidermal apposition will heal fast and prevent surgical site infection. And put a suction drain for short period, but not a corrugated drain, please. Is that right, Dr. Anita?
Yes, sir.
Thank you.
The most important thing is the healing.
Yes, it should heal well. Primary healing.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks very much. So we'll meet again with some new topic of great surgical interest and continue till we have this COVID epidemic, you know, in our society. Thank you very much. So please let us know about the next topic of interest and we will arrange it in a few days' time.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Thank you, ma'am. It was great.
Thank you.
Namaskar.
Namaskar.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, ma'am.